Hey, what's going on YouTube? It's the CJ. It's time to give you guys another update on the reef. I'm going to consider this my last full update of 2016, so we've got a lot to cover. So let's start off with what I'm going to call managing coral losses, if you want to say that. Basically, just dealing with stuff going left, you know, things dying, things just not going according to plan. That's pretty much where we're going to start this vid. We're focusing on the right side of the tank, because that's pretty much what's been causing me the most trouble and headache for the last few weeks. So the first order of business is going to be managing the limited amount of space that I have in my tank already, and that's moving this large green octospine. Now, this is one of my favorite corals. It's been in my tank since, I would say, 4 or 5 months, over a year at this point, and it's grown so much to where it's completely closing off the swim through to the right and damn near crowding out the purple torch on the right. So the mission is to move it maybe an inch or two to the left, open up that swim through, and hopefully reclaim that look I'm looking for. But a word of advice, or caution if I should say, when dealing with octospines, their tissue is a lot softer than any other euphyllia in my system. From what I've noticed, I mean, you touch it, it literally turns to mush and disintegrates. So before you move euphyllia corals, if you can, shake them, irritate them, do something to where you cause them to retract, because the more they retract, the more skeleton you can handle and the safer you're going to be. So just kind of a food for thought FYI for anyone. Handle euphyllia corals with care, keeping in mind that any kind of damage to the tissue could quickly lead to brown jelly or bacterial infections, basically things that can kill your coral. So let's move on to problem number two, and I'm talking about the frog spines on the right side of the tank. Now, this right side of the tank is really just not worked out well for me over the last few months. I think everyone has that one part of the tank to where corals just don't do well, or you just can't get it to look exactly the way you want. This is pretty much it for me. You know, I definitely have a few different theories of why this frog spine is dying and bleaching out, and we're going to address, you know, ways I'm going to try to fix that later in the vid. But for now, it's just about making things look a little bit better. So just removing everything that's dead and trying to rearrange the living corals in a way to where if they do expand or bounce back, it'll completely fill in that section the way I want, basically flowing from frog spine top to bottom and, you know, filling in this space with euphyllia corals movement and just kind of match the overall theme of my tank. Now, you can really go two different ways when it comes to, you know, securing euphyllia corals in your tank, and I've tried both. You know, my first reef tank, I went with the putty or epoxy route, thinking that, hey, it's the best way to secure corals, but I didn't realize it's a permanent way of securing corals. And later, after using it, you know, I wanted to move some things, ended up breaking off euphyllias at the base and shattering different heads of frog spine. It was just a complete failure, to say the least. So in this tank, you know, I've learned my lessons, decided to go with super glue, and in my opinion, it is the best way to secure corals, because it's a non-permanent but sturdy solution. Even if you have a ledge or a crevice or something that you would think it wouldn't hold, it'll work, trust me. And I'm showing you guys now in this video. It took a little effort because of the angle I'm filming. I really couldn't get a right handle on this coral, but I was still able to secure it. And it's literally just attached to the side of this rock. It's not resting on anything. And it definitely proves that super glue can get the job done. You know, in my opinion, the Seachem's Reef Glue is definitely a good choice. But honestly, any super glue gel from any box store will work for your reef tank. So let me introduce you guys to one of the number one troublemakers in my tank, at least for now, and it's going to be this Hollywood Sterner Chalice Coral. Now, I added this, I would say, 8 months or so ago. It was about the size of a dime, I mean, my pinky nail, and I glued it to this rock, just randomly glued it, thinking, not thinking much of it. Hey, I was like, hey, if it grows, it'll encrust along the rock work, it'll be a pretty good look. But I didn't realize just how dangerous these corals are at the time. You know, the sweepers have pretty much destroyed everything around it, definitely are affecting my Setosa coral and my frog spine. So I'm kind of at a fork in the road. I can't really remove this coral without removing the whole rock and potentially damaging more things. But what I can do is break off everything that grows from this. As far as anything that is plating outwards or upwards, I'm snapping it off. So this is kind of going to be the quick fix for now until I figure out the permanent solution. And as far as whatever's left over, I don't really have a frag tank or frag rack, so I literally just kind of flush it. So if anyone's in my area and you want some free Hollywood Sterner Chalice, drop me a inbox or a comment, whatever the case may be. Just be very mindful that this coral is an encrusting coral, and wherever you put it is where it's going to stay. So in the spirit of this being a full update, I'm going to take you guys back behind the tank and give you a look. For anyone that's new, this is a JBJ all-in-one aquarium. So the sump is actually inside of the tank behind this false wall. It includes an overflow, a few weirs for it to go up and down, and a return chamber. So it pretty much houses all the equipment, filtration, everything that keeps my tank alive. Now my hope is, you know, sharing this disgusting filter tray with you guys and, you know, skimmer cup that's completely full gives you guys the motivation you need to get some maintenance done on your tank. Because we all know when it comes to holidays, at least for me, around Christmas, tank maintenance takes a backseat to Christmas shopping and kids and family and just everything else that's more important than the hobby. So, you know, if you're looking at your tank, looking at this vid, take a look at your sections, your filter trays, your sump, get some maintenance done. Now, when it comes to my filtration, I still keep things as easy and as simple as possible. You know, I'm only using filter floss for my mechanical, Seachem's Pine Matrix for my biological. I do have Seachem's Matrix Carbon in my reactor, and then I have my skimmer, of course, and my algae scrubber. So if you're new to my channel and you're wondering what the hell this thing is, I've done an unboxing vid and a few videos about this scrubber, so I'll put those links down below for you. But in a nutshell, it's a nano algae scrubber, and its sole purpose for my tank is to help eliminate phosphates, lower nitrates, and absorb any other additional nutrients that I don't need in my tank, and it does a fantastic job. You know, that's roughly 3 or 4 weeks worth of growth, and I'm pretty happy with it. Now, when I first installed this scrubber, I really had my doubts as far as, you know, it helping pods in my system. But it wasn't until I made this video here that I found my first evidence of pods growing in my algae scrubber. And this sucker is huge. He was actually crawling on my finger as I was holding the box. It was a pretty weird feeling. But, you know, I manned up. I didn't drop it. And I got it on film for you. So, pods in the tank, definitely a good thing. Anytime you get your hands in the tank, anytime that you're handling coral, stressing things out, you know, toxins are released, things come off your skin, and it's just always, always, always a good idea to perform a water change, try to siphon out any of that nastiness, you know, those chemicals, anything that's going to be bad for your tank. It's always a good idea to dilute it. So this is another example of me doing that. I try to do a water change once every week. But here this week, I doubled it up just to make sure I was safe and everything was happy. Now, after doing water changes, the corals are not happy. So, you know, we'll just come back to the tank a little later. I want to take you guys to my LFS. Now, if you had not had a chance to see it, I did a full, you know, store tour interview with the owner on this LFS. It's called Aquatica. Video's in the description. I did it a few months ago. Definitely watch it. And I walked in today, you know, I just wanted to kind of see what he had. And I walked past the tank and it was like, hey man, you know, don't forget about me. I've been here every day you've come for the last 6 months. I got dust on me. The owner really wants to sell me. He'll probably give me away for cheap. I was like, say what? So let me go ahead and check you out, tank. And you know, I started looking them over and I started getting ideas. So, you know, my original thought was to get a 150-gallon cube or 180-gallon peninsula tank. But from what I've researched, the difference between this 93-gallon and 150-gallon is just 6 inches wider both ways. That's it. So definitely the brain's turning and I'm not sure what I'm going to do yet. Now, something I am seriously considering right now, it's going to be upgrading the clowns in my tank. The maroon clown definitely has done his job. You know, he's hosting the anemone. You know, he's not biting me. He's not causing too much of an issue. But when it comes to clownfish breeding in my system or having something a little more attractive to look at, these clownfish are definitely, you know, piquing the interest. So, like I said, it's just a little window shopping, a little brainstorming out loud with you guys. No decisions have been made yet. But let's go ahead and get back to the tank. have problems in this hobby. You know, we have a few corals dying. It's so easy to focus on the negative and, you know, the frog spawns dying on the right side of my system that it's easy to lose sight that the whole rest of the tank is doing fantastic. You know, SPS corals are growing. Things are encrusting. Anemones are happy. You know, every other euphilia in the tank is doing fantastic. So, you know, I just try to make sure I encourage myself as well as encourage anyone else that's watching my vids to know that, you know, struggles come, but you definitely can make it through them. So welcome to the aftermath. You know, this is also known as one day after the water change, and basically what's left of my Hollywood Sterner Chalice coral. I completely butchered this guy. He was a, you know, a perfect semicircle of growing goodness, but ultimately, guys, it had to happen. And when I tell you this, you may be surprised, but this is the third time I've done this to this coral, and it continues to grow back faster and faster each time. But really, there's three main benefits I'm looking for in the immediate future. The first one being, it's no longer shading the monopora that's right below it, and it's also not shading the zoanthus that were growing right behind it. And lastly, the tentacles that extend from this thing at night hopefully will not reach the frog spawn to the right of it anymore now that I've kind of trimmed it back. So time will tell if this works out like I planned. Now, when it comes to the frog spawn on the right side of the tank, or at least the remaining heads, they're still not recovered yet, guys. And honestly, I don't think they're going to do too well from what I can see. You know, the original frog spawn above them, as you can tell, fully open and expanded, but the new guys are still kind of shrunken in and looked a little bleachy. But I'm not really sure the exact reason why. Now, I do have my suspicions that I may have kind of doomed them from the get-go by dipping them in a Revive Coral Cleaner solution that was too strong. I didn't really dilute it enough, and I think that may have kind of doomed this coral. But other than that, it's not really a, you know, too many other things that really can explain it. Besides being stung and stressed out by this chalice coral, I do have one other theory in mind, and we're going to talk about that here in a second. Give you guys a quick livestock update. Unfortunately, this is what I discovered on the bottom of my Jower powerhead. If you can't see, that is my multicolor angelfish. Now, my assumption is this. He was a little skinny when I first purchased him. Even though I got him to eat, he was eating pellets, frozen. I think he may have just been unhealthy to begin with. Maybe a little malnourished, maybe he just couldn't recover. Nevertheless, this is what I found. So I'm back down to one angelfish in my system. I'm still not over my angelfish trio dreams, but they are on pause for now. Now, I'm not sure if you guys have noticed this in your own systems, but the last few weeks, my flame hawkfish has made his mind up to torment and torture and completely, you know, stress out my yellow wrasse, especially when the lights turn off. I'm looking at TV, next thing I hear is water splashing all over the floor. The yellow wrasse literally leaps from the tank to try to escape this guy, so, you know, something's gonna have to change quick, or he's gonna end up getting booted out of the system for a fish that is gonna behave himself a little better. You know, when it comes to managing problems with your fish and corals and, you know, in the hobby in general, it all boils down to troubleshooting problems and how well you can fix an issue. You know, are you just gonna sit there and just bang your head on the wall? Are you gonna start reading, researching, and trying to eliminate, you know, one issue at a time? That's pretty much how I'm trying to approach the bleaching frog spine issue. You know, definitely acknowledge the fact that I may have caused it in the beginning, which just can't be stopped. It's just going to be a dead coral. Or I can also approach it thinking about my water quality and lighting. Now, we're going to talk about lighting for just a second because I can't skip over this. A lot of people may skip over this, not paying attention to the small details. So let me lay them out there for you from my tank. You know, first of all, these lighting I've had on the system for the entire time. I have not changed the settings or the intensity of my lighting for about a year at this point. But why is it still important? Because the settings on your lighting are not the only thing that affect the light penetration or the intensity. The clarity of your water also affects it. Now, this is important because I made a change in my tank about a month or so ago when I recharged the carbon and removed it from the mesh bag and decided to run it in the reactor. Now, why is this important? The reactor forces water through it, you know, makes the carbon work a lot more efficiently, and it also will make the carbon clear my water up a lot more. And if you guys think about dirty water versus clear water, which one does light penetrate more? Of course, the clear water. So clear water in itself could also be a factor when it comes to coral bleaching. So it's definitely something, you know, you got to consider. So keep in mind, it's not the main thing you got to just focus on. Sometimes it's the small details. You know, clear water, corals bleaching adds up to one thing, in my opinion. Remove some of the carbon, turn down some of the intensity of the lighting. That's pretty much all I've done at this point. I've reduced the lighting from 35% blues down to 20% blues and 20% whites down to 10%. So basically down to about 60% of where the power was before. And I'm definitely having some better results. So just want to share that with you guys when it comes to troubleshooting. Definitely try to think outside the box and make sure you consider all things when you're trying to fix an issue. So let's go ahead and talk a little bit about water quality in my system. Because I know some of you guys are new to my channel. You may be wondering, you know, how are you maintaining this reef tank? You know, what are you dosing? What are you using? You know, are you feeding corals? Are you doing any of those things? And the answer is yes and no, to be honest, guys. The only thing I supplement my system with right now is going to be calc and my auto top off. Now, it took me, you know, a few weeks of testing. I used the HANA checker, the alkalinity checker, to kind of help track down my alkalinity usage. And it boiled down to me needing a fully saturated calc solution without adding vinegar yet. You know, that definitely may be coming soon. But basically, the fully normal, you know, 2 teaspoons per gallon saturated RODI water in my auto top off. Now, from what I can tell when testing, it's doing the job, and it's not doing it easily, I would say. It definitely is barely keeping my tank stable, to the point to where any day I have to refill my auto top off, my tank pretty much takes a huge drop in alkalinity because it loses that one day of, you know, calc in my system. So with that being said, 2 things I'm going to have to change. First one being, I'm going to have to make a quick trip to Walmart and definitely, you know, pick up a second auto top off reservoir to where I have 2 of them already ready to go. So that way when I do that change, there's no downtime between the calc being available for my system. That's, you know, that's fix number one. And fix number two will be potentially investing in, you know, some kind of dosing pump or switching over to a different solution, 2-part or some other things that are available. So definitely, you know, not rushing into that. I'm going to cross that bridge when I cross it. But so far, calc's doing the job. Still not giving up on it yet. But I'm going to help myself by getting 2 auto top-off containers. So where does my reef tank stand today? I know some of you guys might be wondering that. Well, according to my test results last night, and my test kits I use are Salifert and HANA checkers, my nitrates are undetectable, and that's still undetectable after only doing 1 water change a week. I can probably go longer than that now with the stock list dropping 1 more fish at this point, but that's good. Now, when it comes to phosphates, I haven't checked them in a while, but I did check them last night. They're still reading in at 0.039 is what they are. They've been that same number for the last 2 or 3 months. I'm fine with that. That's rock solid. And only using the algae scrubber, no phosphate media, keep that in mind. Algae scrubber definitely is helping. And, you know, not many water changes, so I'm going to give credit to the algae scrubber for that. Now, when it comes to calcium, magnesium, alkalinity, alkalinity is setting over 7.5, calcium's at 430, and my magnesium is a little low. It's around 1280 or 1290. It's the lowest it's ever been, actually. So I'm going to have to remedy that with additional water changes. And when it comes to temperature and all that stuff, just normal reef tank stuff there, you know, 78 to 80 degrees, salinity 1.026. And that's pretty much it, guys. So when it comes to parameters, my tank is pretty average. Nothing spectacular, nothing out of the norm as far as, you know, parameters go. But I just try to keep things simple, and my goal is to keep things consistent. You know, consistent, stable parameters by far are the best way to have a successful tank and the best way to have your corals grow and to keep SPS and a mixed reef tank like I have right now. So, you know, in a nutshell, that's pretty much all I have to say about the reef tank. And when it comes to future changes, still don't know yet, guys. You know, if that frog sperm recovers, which I hope it does, great. I'll leave it there. If not, I'm going to replace that with something different. I think I may go back to a torch core, or maybe just get, you know, rid of Euphilias in my mind altogether and just put something different there. But the stock list, that's probably going to get the biggest overhaul for next year. I'm thinking maybe a new pair of clowns, maybe getting rid of that flame hogfish and getting a different type of fish, maybe some Yoshi gobies and a, you know, pistol shrimp, just something different. You know, just keeping something different helps re-energize me with this tank and in the hobby, and, you know, keep me from getting bored, right? So I think I've been rambling on long enough. So if you guys made it this long in the video, thank you. This is probably the longest update I've had for the last few months, but it's a fitting end to 2016 because this is the last update of the year, guys. So other than that, I think we're going to stop here. So hey, if you guys got any other questions, definitely check the description box. Make sure your answer's not there. I got a ton of information there for you. Stock list, parameters, equipment, everything there for anyone new. And other than that, hey, you guys like, comment, subscribe. You guys do what y'all do. Y'all be easy. Happy reefing.